introduction. My wife once took a look at my CV, and she said, "Honey, you look a lot more impressive on paper than you do in person." I'd like to thank all of you for being here today. My only disclosure is that I'm a scientific co-founder of a publicly held biotech company, Kite Pharma. In 1919, fewer than 100 years ago, the foundations for the East Lake campus were laid in the mean field in West Los Angeles. In 1950, the East Lake School of Medicine was established. Dr. William P. Longmire, Jr., a past president of this association, was one of our medical school founders. The first classes and research laboratories were housed in these temporary wooden buildings. Today, UCLA is one of the great research universities in the world, with 2,000 lab faculty educating 40,000 students in a scholarly research environment with a $1 billion per year research portfolio. Similar successes are found at research universities across America and help propel our nation to greatness. Our universities produce outstanding research discoveries, have unparalleled systems of higher learning, educate the best students, and invest vast resources to build excellence as we foster a culture that encourages curiosity and innovation. But how did all this happen? What accounts for this rise to prominence of America's research universities? One important reason is a partnership between universities, industry, and the federal government. This was defined by a committee chaired by Vannevar Bush in 1945, which produced a study entitled Science, the Endless Frontier. The report recommended that the federal government provide research grants to universities through a competitive peer-reviewed system and contracts to industry laboratories for applied research. As a consequence, the National Science Foundation, the National Institutes of Health, NASA, the Department of Energy, and other agencies were established. The Bayh-Dole Act, enacted into law in 1980, gave universities ownership of intellectual property, even if it was funded through federal grants, with the goal of enhancing the delivery of discoveries and innovations to society. Without question, our research universities have made outstanding contributions. But there are clouds on the horizon. Federal funding for research has actually decreased in real dollars. There's been a shift by industry and federal agencies from long-term basic research towards shorter-term product development. Some of the great industrial laboratories have closed, witness Bell Labs. Academia still struggles with the problem of inequality and underrepresentation of women and minorities in many areas, especially the STEM fields, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Too often, the public and elected legislatures view universities as expensive places to get a, quote, college education, or as the home for quasi-professional sports franchises. This perception exists despite the fact that public investment in education research has arguably provided the highest payoff to society in every respect. We are encountering new challenges to which we must respond vigorously. Change is now a reality, and those institutions, or for that matter, professions such as ours, surgery, that cannot adapt to this new reality will become increasingly marginalized. So the theme of my presidential remarks today is how our research universities, the engines of discovery and innovation, need to adapt to a changing and highly competitive global marketplace by fostering a culture of innovation, team science, entrepreneurship, and diversity. Before I begin, I want to acknowledge the various individuals to whom I'm indebted. My family has always been the center of my life. Here's my wife, Denise, with our sons, Peter, George, and Stephen. I'm very proud of them and deeply grateful for their love and support. I received all my education at Johns Hopkins, and individuals who had the greatest influence included Mel Williams, Matt Holmes, who was a resident at the time, my PhD advisor, Yun Shin, Mike Sinner, who was my chief resident, John Cameron, who was not yet chair, and Saul Roseman, the chair of biology. I spent all of my professional career at UCLA and have the privilege of having superb role models. Dr. Longmire, again Mac Holmes, Mike Phelps, again Mike Zinner, our Cancer Center Director, Judy Gassi, our STEM Cell Institute Director, Owen Whitty, my UCLA colleague, Ari Beldegren, and my senior colleague in surgical oncology, Fred Alper, one of the most admired and respected members of the UCLA faculty. My role models in academic surgery are numerous, but those who consistently stand out include Tim Eberline, Rafe Pollack, Charles Balch, Bill Kantz, Steve Rosenberg, and Kirby Bland. My thanks also go to council members, LD, Anna, and Bing, and my fellow officers and committee members. I remember with crystal clarity when my father was notified of his election to the American Surgical Association. It was a warm afternoon, and I was in high school at the time. It was one of the rare instances of self-pride I witnessed him exhibiting. A surgeon, he felt as I do that fellowship in the American was a high privilege in and of itself. I'm still not sure what I did to deserve being president, but I wish he and my mother were here with us today. Shown in this picture are my late parents, Stephen and Catherine, with their 12 successful grandchildren, a photograph taken about 10 years ago. Among the more than 4,000 colleges and universities in the United States, perhaps 60 produce a very high proportion of important and fundamental and practical discoveries in the world. Our institutions are among a select group of preeminent universities that have a major impact on society. We produce and transmit knowledge and serve as powerful engines of change on a global scale. We have a system of higher learning that fosters creativity and discovery, drawing the most talented and motivated students and faculty together on our campuses. We should always appreciate the core values and the types of learning experiences that are essential foundation. Providing the types of learning experiences that are essential foundation, providing critically important human capital to a complex industrialized democracy. In our modern society, a college education is too often viewed primarily as a key to secure employment. Many students enter college already with defined career objectives. They approach college as consumers. What will they get for their effort and financial investment? Undergraduate education is also used as an entry platform for later graduate and professional training. But in the eras of Jefferson and Churchill, an undergraduate education was steeped in philosophy, liberal studies, reading great books. Education was based on inquiry in broad disciplines such as theology, economics, art, ancient history, in ancient languages. Few now recognize that a liberal learning experience with humanities, arts, and social sciences serves as the core foundation for democracy. Great research universities and their constituent professions should always hold the arts, the social sciences, and humanities in high regard, because here's where ideas and values are critically debated, language and writing skills honed, and given dogma challenged. These essential foundations must be laid in secondary and undergraduate education and reinforced in professional and graduate education. The Vannevar Bush Report I mentioned earlier charted a post-World War II program that emphasized the partnership between the federal government and research universities. The key to this partnership was federal support for competitive peer-reviewed research grants and contracts. University faculty and their students had the freedom to engage in research driven by their curiosity. The hope was that great things would happen, and they did. This program allowed and even encouraged research specialization that drove an explosion of new knowledge. Support of basic and applied research profoundly enhanced the scholarly performance of America's research universities, leading them on paths towards preeminence. Although a variety of large and small grant mechanisms were available, far and away the most predominant were those to individual faculty. These R01-like grants supported portions of their salaries, those of research personnel, and supplies to perform the research. These single investor grants also provided support to institutions to offset infrastructure costs, so-called indirects. Faculty were expected to become increasingly successful in obtaining these competitive grants as a key metric in promotion and tenure. Pressure to have large grant portfolios encouraged even more specialization to become preeminent experts in increasingly narrow fields. This model of gladiatorial combat for individual grants worked reasonably well in the eras of generous federal funding, but it isn't working now. The NIH budget is flat. Grant success rates are in decline, and the age of faculty obtaining their first R01 is progressively older. But even if the pay lines were higher, and we could spend more time dreaming instead of writing grants, it still wouldn't be working. That is because the single investigator model is increasingly incapable of tackling the large and complex problems society faces today. We have a social contract with society, the same society that supports us through their tax revenues, philanthropy, and tuition. They expect America's universities to create new knowledge and to educate and train future leaders. And increasingly, they want to know what they're getting for their money. Society also knows that university faculty and students do something called research, but they don't always know exactly what that means or how much we contribute to the world around us. We need to make our impact more noticeable. We need to commit to delivering measurable and achievable and lasting impacts on major problems in society. These are society's grand challenges: health, poverty, environment, inequality, unemployment, problems that cannot be solved in the legislatures, nor in the courts, nor in the private sector. By tackling these problems as a university, we are leveraging the public's investment and providing an even better return. Furthermore, we are preparing students to share the same commitment. This new culture requires an evolution in our academic culture and new systems of support. This requires an entrepreneurial mindset in which we are neither emulating or competing with peer institutions, but defining overarching and compelling missions, developing a strategy, defining a set of concrete activities and metrics to achieve these goals, focusing on problem-based challenges, accelerates the creation of new knowledge, and through successful translation, leads to societal benefit and economic growth. This requires us to reevaluate everything we do as inhabitants of our university ecosystems and continue to readjust to meet the needs and expectations of the changing world in which we live. This will be accomplished in the 21st century through the promotion of transdisciplinary team science and scholarship, our ability to innovate in highly competitive arenas, to build entrepreneurial ecosystems that create and deliver discoveries and innovations to society, and to recognize that diversity in all its forms, disciplinary background, gender, ethnicity, race, promotes excellence. Research institutions, or for that matter, disciplines such as ours that embrace this new culture will be the preeminent engines of discovery and innovation in the 21st century. This is the old world model we live in. Faculty and students are herded into divisions and departments, which are then grouped into schools. The deans overseeing these schools report to a president or chancellor, and they all say, hey, look at us, look what we have here. Don't look at the other deans, look at me. With an expectation that they will receive more money, more space, and more prestige. But I believe there's a potential for a much more robust new world model for scholarship and research. I call this the small box model. Small teams of faculty and their students go into the small box and work with each other because they want to be the best in the world at something. They don't really care what department or school they're in, or for that matter, what university holds their faculty appointment. They each dream about being the best in the world at something and contributing to society. They invite other scholars into this box, making it larger, but only including those who are like-minded and passionate about making discoveries and innovations and delivering solutions to society. This is one reason they came to the university in the first place. This is what we call team science, which is different than collaboration. It is true coordinated teamwork focused on solving problems, large and small. Problems that cannot be solved by the sole investigator. Our universities are not currently constructed to easily allow such diverse teams to purposely self-assemble in such a manner. But things are changing. I would like to share with you how my colleagues and I have come to appreciate this new culture with the following example. The program in Engineering Unity is a team science effort involving faculty and students from several Southern California institutions, UCLA, Caltech, USC, and the City of Hope. The program aims to advance the field of complex cell and gene-based immune therapies for cancer. Immunotherapy is finally emerging as the third pillar of systemic cancer therapy, alongside small molecules and recombinant proteins. Cell-based therapies are one approach in which an otherwise ineffective immune system can be re-engineered to mount a potent anti-tumor response in patients. We recognized that no one laboratory, maybe not even a single institution, could move the basic science and supporting clinical and translational platform quickly enough in such a rapidly developing field of cancer medicine. We recognized that an innovative approach was necessary. The proximal biological event in T lymphocyte immune responses is the recognition of tumor antigen on the surface of cancer cells by highly specific T cell receptors encoded in our T cell repertoire. Cytotoxic T cells can then effect the delivery of death signals to tumor cells. One of the problems is that our immune system has too few of these cancer-specific T cells. One strategy to increasing the precursor frequency of antigen-reactive T cells is to genetically engineer them to express antigen-specific receptors. This is done by cloning high-affinity cancer-specific T cell receptors or creating chimeric antigen receptors, or CAR, essentially single-chain antibody molecules hooked up to an intracellular signaling molecule. Gene therapy vectors can then be used to introduce these new cancer-specific receptors ex vivo into naive T cells. In this strategy of genetic engineering of the human immune system, peripheral blood T cells are harvested from the patient by leukapheresis. The patient receives a short course of chemotherapy to deplete their ineffective immune system. The T lymphocytes retrieved from the patient are genetically engineered ex vivo with a gene therapy vector that introduces a new cancer-specific cell surface receptor. This is a transduction process requiring only a few days. The receptor-engineered T cells are then re-administered to the patient, where they expand by orders of magnitude, repopulate the patient's lymphoid organs, and create a new immune system that can seek out and destroy cancer cells throughout the body. In one of our early trials, we introduced a melanoma antigen, T-cell receptor engineered lymphocytes, into patients with metastatic melanoma. These cells rapidly expanded in vivo, and almost one-fourth of the patient's immune systems became cancer-specific. They trafficked to all sites of tumor, and almost all of our patients had a dramatic response within weeks. You can see the before and after responses on this PET scan. But all of these patients relapsed within 3 to 6 months, and we couldn't figure out what was going on. We realized that a lot of science needed to be done. What do the cells need to be engineered? CD8 or CD4 T cells? Should they be central memory or effector memory phenotype? Or maybe NK cells, dendritic cells, hematopoietic stem cells, embryonic stem cells, or induced pluripotent stem cells? With what cancer-specific receptor should they be engineered? T cell receptors recognizing class 1 or class 2 endogenic epitopes? Second or third generation chimeric antigen receptors, and to which cancer antigens? Can these cells be engineered to enhance their anti-tumor biology when adoptively transferred back to patients? Can they be made to kill better, persist longer, track better to tumor, and when they get their function better in a hostile tumor environment? How can we better monitor the evolution of newly engineered immune system in patients, preferably non-invasively, or nothing more than the use of a small needle? Here is where a diversity of coordinated expertise was essential. Basic immunology and molecular biology, preclinical animal models, imaging science, computational biology, clinical trials translation, biostatistics, medical ethics, and cancer medicine. We dreamt about iteratively applying this basic immune biology research into therapies that would change the care of patients. So we formed, almost 10 years ago, the program in engineering community under the leadership of David Baltimore, who was president of Caltech at the time. It began as a small box. We initially invited half a dozen scientists and their students to join us. Our plan was to create a hub of innovation that would introduce new ideas, new methods, and new devices in our goal-oriented program to change the care of patients. This requires us to become entrepreneurs, but I'm not using the term entrepreneurship as a commercialization exercise, although, as I will show you later, this became one of our byproducts. The French economist J.B. Say defined an entrepreneur as one who shifts the resources out of an area of lower into an area of higher productivity. If you think of this definition of entrepreneurship, it is entirely consonant with the way I think research universities should function. We already live with risk and uncertainty. We have learned how to be comfortable with ambiguity and change. And with the right approach, we can tackle large, complex problems as a team. Universities can apply substantial resources, focusing on a single goal, where the best minds in the world can create new knowledge. Every few months, we meet at Caltech or UCLA on a Saturday morning for about 4 hours and go over everyone's data and try to figure out what to do next. Leadership in these meetings is a shared activity distributed among many members of this team effort. We also felt that a diverse membership would advance our goals in a cross-functional manner. Jim Heath and Xiao Ma from Caltech, who had chemistry and physics backgrounds, started showing up at our meetings and became interested in human cancer biology. They wanted to help us figure out why these melanoma patients did not have durable responses. They developed a microfluidic platform that allowed T cells from our patients to be individually assayed for dozens of secreted proteins and surface receptors, hundreds of thousands of data points per blood sample. We sent them blood from these initial patients and they came back and showed us that the cells we were administering were highly efficient killer cells, but by day 90 they were essentially non-functional. They were exhausted. So we needed physical scientists to help us understand this human biology. More people kept coming to our meetings. The small box was becoming a larger box. Lily Yang, then a graduate student in the Baltimore Laboratory, was one of the founding members of our engineering community group. She demonstrated that in mice, reprogrammed blood hematopoietic stem cells created a potent anti-tumor immune response. Don Cohn, a pediatrician and a medical oncologist, Anthony Rivas, from whom you'll be hearing tomorrow in a mini-symposium, became interested in the possibility of genetically engineering hematopoietic stem cells in cancer patients. They thought that having a continuous supply of human transgenic T cells from human engineered hematopoietic stem cells might deal with the problem of T cell exhaustion that we were seeing with mature effector cells that we were giving in just a single infusion. They have now constructed a lentiviral vector encoding a cancer-specific T cell receptor to test this hypothesis. They first modeled the candidate vector in an immune-deficient mice and showed that their bone marrow compartments were reconstituted with engineered hematopoietic stem cells, that they produced cancer-specific T cells. Planned shortly will be a first-in-man clinical trial of hematopoietic stem cell-engineered tumor immunity. We invited Steve Foreman and Christine Brown from City of Hope to join the engineered immunity group. They are experts in the design and clinical testing of the chimeric antigen receptor. These cell-based therapies have potential beyond melanoma and B-cell malignancies. At City of Hope, they have active programs for AML, multiple myeloma, exciting early clinical results in glioblastoma, and preclinical models targeting antigens expressed in prostate, breast, and cervical cancer. A student from the University of Pennsylvania, who is now a surgery resident there, spent a year in my laboratory and worked with the young basic science to try to figure out how to make these transgenic T cells kill tumor better in vivo. One of the signals they saw in the Caltech data was TGF-beta, an immunosuppressive cytokine. They hypothesized that making these T cells insensitive to TGF-beta by introducing a dominant negative receptor would make them function better in the tumor microenvironment. They showed that these dominant negative transgenic T cells, shown on the right-hand graph, could cure mice far more efficiently. The young basic scientist Richard Coy took this project and helped write his first and turned out successful R01 grant to conduct a clinical trial using melanoma T cell receptor engineered T cells with this TGF-beta dominant negative receptor. Here's an example of junior members whose careers were advanced in this team science model. We follow most of our patients with PET CT scans, which measures the metabolic activity of tumors and their CT correlates. Here's a PET CT scan of a complete response of synovial cell sarcoma to an NY-ESO T cell receptor adoptive cell therapy. The PET substrate images the tumor response, but tells us very little about the immune response affected in this response. A biochemist and immunologist, Kaius Radu, began attending our meetings. Kaius is a member of our pharmacology department led by Mike Phelps, the co-developer of the PET scan, from whom you'll also be hearing tomorrow in our symposium. Kaius wanted to design PET substrates to try to image an immune response in humans. To make a long story short, he synthesized and tested several generations of probes based on substrates for deoxycytidine kinase. He finally produced a third-generation substrate, F18-CFA, that images activated lymphocytes. This is a patient with metastatic melanoma who responded to CTLA-4 PD-1 blocking antibody combination. You can see enhanced F18-CFA PET probe uptake by activated lymphocytes surrounding the axillary tumor. Jerry Zak and Zoran Gallic started coming to our meetings. They're basic scientists, and they're experts in embryonic stem cells. They wanted to know if they could differentiate human embryonic stem cells into melanoma-specific T cells. Zorin spent 2 years on this one project. He took human embryonic stem cells, differentiated them into T cell progenitors, introduced a melanoma specific T cell receptor, put them into immune deficient mice with human thymic implants, and isolated CD8 T cells a few months later. In this video clip, the green colored cells are transgenic T cells, and the red cells are melanoma cells. They're mixed together in cell culture. Cells kill every melanoma cell in culture. This was the first demonstration of its kind ever. One of our senior scientists, Gay Crooks, has extended their work. She has devised an entirely in vitro culture system to differentiate human stem cell progenitors into mature T lymphocytes. From one progenitor, she can obtain a 100-fold expansion. This obviously has the potential as an entirely off-the-shelf cell manufacturing capability using pluripotent stem cells that can be extensively engineered genetically using modern gene editing technologies. Finally, I introduced Lily Yang to you when she was a graduate student at Caltech. We recruited her to UCLA, where she is now one of the best-funded basic science assistant professors. Lily has asked whether another kind of immune cell, invariant NKT cells, could be engineered as anti-cancer effectors. These are rare cells in our blood that can be expanded in large numbers and transduced with T cell receptors. And they suppress tumors beautifully. Lily was just awarded a $7.6 million grant to conduct a translational clinical trial. Another example of the career success of a junior member of the Team Science Consortium. And we're very proud of her. Our team's been pretty successful in competing for extramural support. First, some smaller R01 grants in the $1 million range, and then larger center and program grants, now totaling over $120 million. But the key to all of this has been team science. But do teams really produce better science? It isn't intuitively obvious that they should, since large teams carry with them coordination and social network costs. However, there's ample evidence that team science is becoming a more common strategy in bioscience and that it's paying off. There's a higher percentage of team-authored papers than ever before. More patents are produced by teams, and team science papers are cited more often. Elite research universities have played a leading role in this trend. This is what is needed to tackle major societal problems in the 21st century. Complex problems require multifaceted solutions, and universities should foster these kinds of problem-oriented team organizations across disciplines. Diverse research teams encourage innovation and cannot be dominated by a single disciplinary perspective. If approached the right way, the benefits of team science and scholarship would be great. Some lessons we've learned through our experience is that team members must teach each other. Team learning enhances respect and trust. Team science must ensure the career success of students and junior faculty who are drawn to the intellectual rewards but may be deterred by the professional risks as they face tenure roads. Teams must actively promote individual creativity and curiosity-driven scholarship. Leaders must sublimate their egos and self-interest. Conversely, individuals who do not share these values of mutual respect and trust must be asked to leave the team. This is an appropriate time for me to restate my financial disclosure as a scientific co-founder of the biotech company Kite Pharma. Several of us on the USA faculty have long-standing careers in cancer immunotherapy, immunotherapy that is now beginning to help patients. We realized that our research wasn't fully realized until it could be of much broader benefit to society. Heretofore, these complex cell and gene-based therapies were limited to a handful of very well-funded academic and federal research enterprises. So a few of us decided it was time to create a biotech startup. There were four scientific founders of this organization, three surgeons, and one basic scientist. Parenthetically, Ari Beldegren, a UCLA professor of urology, and I, 25 years ago, led the first genetically engineered adoptive cell therapy trial in the Western United States. So we've all been interested in cell-based immunotherapy for a long time. We formed Kite Pharma 6 years ago. Under Beldegren's leadership, like-minded individuals were brought into this small box, which was now becoming quite large. Investors, scientists, a board of directors, a scientific advisory board, attorneys. From the pharmaceutical industry, experts in manufacturing, quality and compliance, business development, clinical development, a COO, a CFO, many acronyms, many vice presidents, and more scientists. We established a European site, built two cell processing facilities, and formed multiple business collaborations. The company went public, and in six rounds of financing, raised $70 million. Kite Pharma now has opened a registration trial of adoptive cell therapy, has over 200 employees, and a market valuation of $2.5 billion. But the key again has been team science. Kite Pharma is an example of a heterogeneous, interdisciplinary team drawing together talent from the academic and the private sectors. This team needed to work effectively together in divisions of labor, communication, and knowledge transfer. This team needed to establish milestones, seek non-academic sources of funding, reconcile the cultures of university faculty, venture capitalists, and the pharmaceutical industry, and stay focused on the goal of bringing a good idea to practical benefit. Because the work of the university isn't really done until there's a benefit to society. Our faculty want to teach, do research, and engage in scholarship, but they also want to serve society and its needs. It is a lost opportunity for research universities to make discoveries, invent new technologies, and spur innovation unless there's an efficient way to deliver these benefits to society. This requires a pathway for innovation and entrepreneurship. I want to describe to you how our campus, through a blueprint drafted when I served as our university's senior research officer, began transforming our campus entrepreneurship into a modern 21st century paradigm. This is the reality of the old paradigm. You can see at the bottom of this investment pyramid that from 1,000 disclosures that a university tech transfer office receives, maybe one might be a home run that will yield a multi-million dollar licensing and royalty stream, usually from a therapeutic. 9 out of 1,000 will be base hits that will generate no more than $1 million. About 500 of these discoveries will be no real value. But the other half, even if they do not generate significant licensing or royalty income, are important to our faculty. They represent their creativity and innovation, and one of the reasons they chose a life in the academy. Delivering these innovations and discoveries to society is what a research university should be doing, even if it's not making any money in the process. But a shrewd, business-like approach to capitalizing on these potential home runs and base hits will provide licensing and royalty revenue that will benefit not just the inventors, but the university at large. This requires a commercial pathway for entrepreneurship. This is the way things generally work in a tech transfer office, trying to get their intellectual property off their books as quickly as possible so they can recoup patent expenses. They usually do an early handoff to venture capitalists and biotech startups. We all know that the value transition point is not a handoff. That's when biotech matures and de-risks the intellectual property, gets the proof of concept phase 1 clinical trial completed. This then significantly increases its value before turning it over to the farmer. This busy diagram illustrates a new paradigm of an entrepreneurial university. In this new model, research discoveries and innovations and scholarship are kept longer within the university, where they undergo rigorous technology assessment, business mentoring, and a business-driven patent investment process with opportunities to partner with industry. Competitive proof of concept grants are used to mature select intellectual property and perhaps place them in campus incubators or accelerators. The longer these can be kept within the university environment, the greater opportunity there is for faculty startups, maturation of intellectual property, the creation of mutually beneficial academic industry partnerships, and even to conduct proof of concept phase one clinical trials. This maturation process moves the value transition point more to the university and its faculty inventors, and will allow our university to spin up more companies and directly license more valuable intellectual property. I learned four key lessons about creating a commercial pathway for entrepreneurship. Establish a culture of entrepreneurship on campus. Manage conflicts rather than avoid them. Create value on campus and get the best business expertise to make informed decisions. Our entrepreneurial university should be turning good ideas into practical benefit. I've described to you a team science effort that has capitalized on diversity of expertise, the benefits of which are obvious. Perhaps less obvious are the benefits of social diversity, race, ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation. Gender bias is still pervasive in many professions, including medicine. I addressed these in an editorial in Surgery published a year and a half ago. The advancement of women in academic biomedical science is reduced at every career milestone, despite being at near parity in MD and MD PhD training. In the biomedical fields, women are underrepresented in lateral faculty, in certain disciplines, in leadership positions. There are disparities in compensation, longer time to tenure, issues of work-life balance, all stacking against the deck, against their full participation in the academy. There are multiple factors that impede women's progress in the professoriate. Sub-discrimination based on cultural stereotypes, implicit biases that may even be outside of conscious awareness can affect career decisions at every stage of one's career. These subtle reminders to women of their stereotyped identities can cumulatively reduce their socialization in the academic workforce, and especially their participation in various fields, especially the STEM fields. So there may be conscious and unconscious selection processes that may have deterred talented women from entering and advancing in our professions. My father, a staunch advocate for women in surgery, used to tell me, women in surgery need to be better to be equal. So he frequently chose better. My father wasn't the only department chair who advocated for diversity in general surgery. This is Dr. Busatil's most recent graduating class of chief residents. Between Lorraine Kelly Kwan, Elise Lawson, Danielle Sue, and Amy Leiter, they've got 9 children, 4 boys and 5 girls. So in surgery, we are filling the pipeline. But our responsibility is to keep it wide open all the way to the top. For ethnic and racial minorities, the disparities in the academy are even worse and start earlier in the pipeline. Minority students tend to view predominantly white campuses as hostile, alienating, and socially isolating. They feel that universities are less responsive to their needs and interests, and thus can feel estranged from the campus community of faculty and peers. They may have heightened concerns over academic preparedness, added to an easiness of family expectations and finances. Hurtado and Sorozano have divined several themes of campus and racial climate. the incongruence of stated institutional values regarding diversity and the reality. An aversion to discussions about race, racial self-segregation on campus, gaps in social satisfaction according to race, and an overestimation of minority student satisfaction. At the graduate professional levels of education and in the professoriate, racial ethnic disparities in the ladder rank and leadership positions are even more severe. These disparities extend even to competitiveness in securing extramural grant support. Ginther reported that black investigators were 13% less likely to be awarded R01 grants after controlling for education, training, and publications. This could be due as much to unconscious bias in the review process as to the lack of academic role models, poor mentorship, and a less supportive academic environment. This should concern us not just because of unfairness and social injustice in what should be an academic meritocracy. Institutions that value new ideas and innovations need to embrace both intellectual diversity and social diversity. Diversity leads to better problem solving, since exposure to diverse points of view can change the way one thinks. People from another race or gender can bring their unique perspectives to bear on complex problems. Healthcare disparities is an obvious example, but there are many others in the fields of public policy, law, social science, global health, and biomedical team science. People work harder and perform better in socially diverse environments. We should strive to create a university environment that embraces diversity, in all its forms. A commitment to diversity allows institutions to draw from a broad and deep talent pool that invigorates teaching and scholarship. Diversity research supports different perspectives and experiences that challenge long-held assumptions and create new methods of inquiry. Diversity is an essential element in sustaining the quality of scholarship and education. This will require multi-level interventions, a collegial work environment, better mentorship, recognition of differences in work-life balance. Excellence and diversity are mutually reinforcing objectives for the 21st century research university. Well, many of you have been patiently sitting here wondering what any of this has to do with surgery. Our profession still adheres to the 19th century German model of a department with divisions and sections, reporting up a chain of command to a chair, to a dean, and to a provost, and a president, It's a structure based on the instruments we use to do our work and the boards which hold our certifications. But it's not necessarily a structure that actually makes a great deal of sense with regard to the study and treatment of human disease. Our medical profession is not easily constructed to allow diverse scholars to purposely self-assemble in a manner to optimize innovations in discovery based biomedical research, education, and delivery of patient care. As research universities continue to differentiate in the 21st century, I believe they will increasingly discard the academic compartmentalizations of the 19th century. Traditional academic disciplines, biology, chemistry, physics, and to an even greater degree, internal medicine, surgery, radiology, while serving as convenient administrative homes to process promotion dossiers and paychecks, will no longer work as well to organize science. They are not the optimal structures to address major societal challenges. Increasing specialization drives the need for boundaryless collaboration. Since an individual department cannot encapsulate a fraction of what's needed for large impact science, it demands a results-oriented, cross-disciplinary mindset. It needs to be compelled by a mission in which innovation is central to its solution, which is in turn enabled by entrepreneurship. If we're presented with a radio that's broken, we can open it up. A narrow specialist will look at a little transistor and say, well, this is kind of interesting. I wonder what it does. They will take it out and study it and then write some papers and get a grant, and then they'll move on to another little gizmo. But the radio won't get fixed. We are quickly evolving into an era where patients and the NIH and the government and industry want results. Our surgical temperament is well suited to keeping everyone on target. We can look at the broken radio as a whole, a simplistic systems biology view of interdependent pathways perturbed by single malfunction, form a diverse team, and actually get the radio fixed. I'd like to thank you for the privilege of being a fellow and serving as the 136th president of the American Surgical Association. God bless all of you.